Hello everybody and welcome back to another video. A very special and different video, I'd say. Please excuse me, I got a new Keurig for Christmas and it's my favorite thing now. But that is not why you're here for show and tell. That's for another day. Today you're here because you like Asian cinema, perhaps. And I do too. The little bit of Asian cinema I have seen, I do enjoy a lot of good South Korean stuff, a lot of good Japanese stuff. But here's the story, and here's the dilemma, here's what's going on. A few months ago, Seth and I decided to go pro on Letterboxd. It allows you to go in and see a bunch of stats, make lists. It's basically like an extended profile that displays stats such as the countries of films you've seen, the directors you've seen the most films from, very tidy and specific lists on there that you can keep track of what you've seen in those lists, and there's some neat ones in there too. There's all the best picture winners, the top 100 animation, 1001 films to see before you die. But the one that caught my attention was the Letterboxd top 250. And when I looked at this list, there was something that I had noticed. There was something missing, something askew. Now, can you tell me what you noticed from this list? What are some of the films that have not been watched? There are quite a few masterpieces of Asian cinema that I have yet to watch, for no other reason besides sheer coincidence, I guess. It's not like I went out of my way not to watch them, but for some reason I just haven't. So what I decided to do, and I wanted to share with everybody, go along this journey with me, is I want to go through this list and watch a good amount of the Asian cinema that I have not checked out. Almost think of it as a vlog slash vignettes of movie nights. I'm just gonna treat each one as its own individual movie night slash review slash hangout. Now you may be asking yourself, why do this? Well, a variety of reasons. For one, I would like to become more accustomed and in the know of Asian cinema, especially some of the best ones that the world has to offer. And maybe one of the more fun, easier, interesting ways to do that is to bring you along with me, treat them as movie nights, because I know a lot of you really want to see some movie nights. And maybe if there's a good one in this stash here, then you can check it out. Maybe you'll enjoy it. Maybe I can recommend something for you that some of you may have never seen before. So if you've even clicked on this video, it's much appreciated. I know that this may not be the usual sort of content we have here, but I wanted to do something a little bit different. So let us know down below if you want to see some different things like this. I have no real game plan of how I'm going to tackle each movie and which ones I'm going to do and what order. So we're all going to be surprised as this goes along. So I think that about covers everything. And yeah, let's just jump into it and see what we get into. Day one of this Asian cinema festival that we're having. Yeah, this is something that I like to do, especially with longer movies that I've never seen before, is I like to get up early. I like to make some coffee. I like to get the mood just right. I don't know why. I think that there's just a feeling that I've started to manufacture when I wake up early and watch a foreign film or any longer type of film, maybe because it makes the day feel like I still have plenty of it when it's over. But the first one that we're going to start with on our journey is Edward Yang's Yi Yi.
Yi Yi!
From 2000. This one's 174 minutes and tells the story of each member of a family in Taipei asks hard questions about life's meaning as they live through everyday quandaries. Sounds lovely.
Stop it! Stop eating that! Stop it! Stop it!
It's currently sitting with a 4.4 rating on Letterboxd. That's pretty good! Why don't we stop talking? And why don't we start manufacturing the aesthetic so we can get ready to start this one? All right, we're about an hour deep into the film. So far, so good. Really enjoying it.
I did want to look up and see what Yi Yi meant. The title in Chinese means one by one, meaning one after another. When written in vertical alignment, the two strokes resemble the character for two. Don't know what that means.
Learning a lot about the characters. Really love so far the minimalistic and realistic style of the acting. There's nothing that feels forced. There's nothing that feels fake. It just feels very authentic and real. Yeah, if the second half is anything like this, this is gonna be a good one. I have a good feeling about this one so far, as long as things stay on track. I do want to talk about these real quick. These are Mpow Bluetooth headphones. I use these to watch films now by the recommendation of Seth. Seth Talks Film. These really accentuate the viewing experience. The sound is fantastic. Very bassy. You hear everything. There are some moments where I hear things. They make me check my corners. They make me check behind my back to make sure nobody's there, because you hear everything. Very great quality for the price. I think I got these for around 40 or 50 bucks, but I suggest these to anyone who wants a cheap alternative to soundbars or anything. These really enhance the viewing experience. I'll put a link down below for these if anybody's curious. But why don't we go ahead and keep going, see where we end up. Alright, wow. Yi Yi in the books. What a fantastic film. What a great way to start off this little festival we've got going on. Where to begin? Love the naturalistic vibe of it. It just feels very, very lived in. It feels like we're jumping into the lives of a family that existed before the movie and will exist after the movie, and we're just getting this little taste of what is going on in their life and how they're dealing with personal issues and how they're dealing with each other. I just felt like we were watching people, not characters. Maybe like even like a documentary. It just felt so natural, so neorealistic. The music was very subtle, but when it did come in, it was fantastic. There was some great imagery throughout too. There's a specific shot that I just really stuck out and I loved. It's a reflection shot, but the way that the lights are, there's a flashing light that makes it look like a beating heart. It's just lovely. It really harkens to the shot from Schindler's List. It really reminded me of that shot. Interesting characteristics to all the family, and I'm just so happy with this first film. I couldn't find a flaw in it at all. It's perfection, and it's a good way to start. If Brighter Summer Day is anything like this, we're in for a treat. Hey there, everybody. Welcome back to day two of our fantastic Asian Film Festival. Thought about it, since I called it a festival, maybe at the end we'll give away some awards to the best films and directors and actors and all that good stuff. Make it a little bit of our own little festival. How about that? Sounds fun. Anyways, today we're going to be checking out Tokyo Story by Yasuhiro Ozu. Now this one is from 1953 and it is 134 minutes and it's currently sitting at a 4.4 on Letterboxd. I've seen one Ozu before, Good Morning, which I enjoyed, so I'm hopeful for this one. I've seen the Criterion countlessly when we go for the Criterion sale. I never thought to pick it up for some reason, but it is on the channel, so we'll be flipping that on and getting that going. It tells the story of a couple aging parents who travel to Tokyo to see their grown children who don't seem to have too much time for them, so they become close with their widowed daughter-in-law. So I'm hopeful. It sounds good. It kind of reminds me a little bit of Make Way for Tomorrow with that description where the kids are just too busy for the parents. So we'll see how it is and we'll get that going. It is a black and white film, so we need to switch on the lights to get this going. So how about that? Black and white. Here we are. Back in the good old days.
But as per usual, before we get this little thing going, we gotta get the aesthetic going. Let's make some more coffee, shall we?
やめてたのにまた飲んじゃって。
どこで飲んできたんだよ。
どこだか、だらしやねえ。お父さん昔はよく飲んだのよ。宴会だってていつもぐでんぐでんになってきて、なんだかんだってお母さん困らせたもんよ。嫌でね、私たち。それがやっと京子が生まれる自分からまるで人が変わったみたいにすっかりやめちゃって、いい塩梅だと思ってたのに。
Okay, so we're about halfway through, and we have a lot to talk about. There's a lot of things going on so far in the story. The children are too busy for the parents. The parents are dissatisfied with their children. And yeah, a lot of real life issues that families deal with on a daily basis. My first reactions were the acting is a little bit stiff, but I think that's just a product of the time and the culture and the place, so can't blame it too much for that. But the interactions at the very beginning were realistically awkward, as if you hadn't seen your family in a long time and you don't know how to interact with them, and or how to, you're walking on eggshells around them just to get a feel for them. I thought that the interaction between all of them was pretty authentic and awkward. And I also noticed that I think it's something that Ozu may have, if he didn't start it, he definitely made it more popular, but the camera angles with the actors looking directly at the camera, it's interesting. I don't know how much I love it, but it is inventive and interesting. There was also a moment where the daughter told the mother to wear her wooden sandals, which prompted me to want to look up why they wore wooden sandals in the first place. Three reasons why you should have geta. Because of the extra height, they can be worn during rainy days or even the winter season without worrying about mud or snow. Sushi chefs who wore extremely tall geta sandals to avoid soiling their feet with fish scraps. To apprentice geishas who donned distinctive geta footwear called a kobo. This custom has permeated throughout Japanese culture. So I guess I still wear them. And essentially the three reasons are healthy for your feet and helps you maintain a natural posture. It's also eco-friendly and they just look cool. Interesting. See, I'm learning so much about culture with this. I'm learning about different cultures and why they do some things. But on to the meat and potatoes. We're having a lot of deep discussions going on, especially now that the father Shukishi is off hanging out with some of his friends. They're talking about losing children during the war. So this came, I mean, not long after the war. It was 1953, which was only 8 years after the war had ended. So it's still pretty fresh. It's still pretty relevant to Japan. That's the reason why Shukishi lost his son, is because of the war, and he's having back and forth with some of his friends in Tokyo. And they lost sons in the war, and it's just a really destructive thing that has broken these families. And they're also just talking about their dissatisfaction with their kids and how they're kind of disappointed in what they've become. And then it goes back and forth with the kids. The kids are just, they're too busy, which of course that's what happens in life. They just don't seem to really want to make the effort to try and do anything with the parents, which is a little disappointing. But that's it. That's just how it is. It happens now in modern times. So now the widower daughter-in-law, Noriko, has to come in and take care of them because the kids don't want to. So also a little worried too, because the mother said she's feeling a little dizzy. So I'm hoping that this doesn't go down a destructive path, but we're about halfway through, so let's finish this up and then we'll discuss it. Alrighty, we done did it, folks. Tokyo Story in the books. Another really good film. That's for sure. Just want to get my gripes out of the way real quick. I think a lot of the delivery feels really unnatural, like more so than a lot of the films from this time period. Personally, I don't know how much I like the looking straight at the camera to talk to the characters, especially when the delivery feels kind of wooden in it. But it didn't take too much away from the movie because the movie itself is really good. And I did look it up. It seems that it was based on Make Way for Tomorrow purposefully, so makes sense. It is different in its own way, though. I will be talking a little bit of spoilers, not only for this movie, but for Gran Torino. And just be aware of that throughout the rest of the video, that I may go into spoilers from here on out. It did happen. Mama died. The dizziness did mean something after all. What I found interesting was that one of the sons said that she died because she was overweight, and then earlier in the film, the daughters said that she had gotten fatter, and she was not, like, in any way fat. If only they could see people today, they would probably change their minds about that.
And finally, the biggest people. America has now become the fattest nation in the world. Congratulations.
But yeah, she passed away, and then the other daughter, she wanted her stuff. Rather callously was talking about what she wanted immediately after her mom died, which is very realistic. That's how people are. But I thought it was way more subtle in this than other films, like say Gran Torino, for example. It was very in your face that his grandchildren were assholes and his family just wanted what they could get from him, including the car. And it was not very subtle in that movie, but this was a little more subtle. She asked for it, and then they kind of move on from it, but then you find out how the other daughter, how it really affected her, and just how she thought her sister was so low to do such a thing. Tokyo Story was really good. So far, we're 2 for 2, and that's a good sign. But from here on out, we've got some heavy hitters. We've got some long films, and some of the same actors that are in Tokyo Story will be in some of the other films we watch from here on out. So, get familiar. Hello, everybody. It's early. 6:44 in the morning. It's another week of our extravaganza. It's also FA Cup week. Manchester United, they're going to be playing Watford today. I know we have a decently big UK audience. I'm always curious what football teams you guys support. But anyway, sports, that's not why we're here. We are here because we're about to watch another movie. Which movie, you ask? Today we're going to be watching Harakiri by the director Masaki Kobayashi. This film was from 1962. It's 135 minutes, so not exactly that giant film that I promised last time. But I do have the schedule for what I want to watch the next couple weeks. And this guy did one of them. I mean, this, I already looked at the cast and the director of this film. They've done so many great things. Masaki, he's also done Kwaidan. He's done the Human Condition films, which, spoiler alert, I think that's what we're gonna do next week, is the first Human Condition film. Jesus, even the main actor, Tetsuya Nakadai. Okay, let me just kind of ring off some of his greatest hits. Seven Samurai, Ran, Harakiri, Tale of the Princess Kaguya, Yojimbo, High and Low, Kwaidan, The Face of Another, Sendero, Sword of Doom. I mean, it just goes on and on with him. But yeah, Harakiri, it's on the Criterion Channel, so we're gonna pop that up. Aging samurai Hanshiro Sugumo arrives at the home of Kagyu Saito and asks to commit a ritual suicide on the property, which Saito thinks is a ploy to gain pity and a job. Saito tells Sugumo of another samurai, Motomo Shijiwa, who threatened suicide as a stratagem, only to be forced to follow through on the task. When Sugumo reveals that Shijiwa was his son-in-law, the disclosure sets off a fierce conflict. I'm going to be very honest, don't love samurai films. Like, for example, Seven Samurai, while I really appreciate everything else about it, I didn't love it as much as I would have wanted to. And that was also, shit, probably 5 years ago that I watched it, so it could easily be. Maybe I just love them now. Maybe I love samurai films. We won't know until we get this started. So, without further ado, let's go make some coffee again, and let's start this bad boy.
Osaka no jinrai, 刃の下をくぐるのまさに拙者16年ぶり。首を取るのも難しい。しかし曲げだけ頂戴するはさらに一苦労。
All right, we're about halfway through this one. Just like every other film, what does harakiri mean? And I looked it up, and of course it means exactly what the description said. Ritual suicide by disembowelment with a sword, formerly practiced in Japan by samurai as an honorable alternative to disgrace or execution. So I guess what is the difference between that and seppuku? Oh, another term for harakiri. Well, there we go. Learning more every day. Honestly thought though this would be a bit of a slog, but so far, really enjoying it. It has a non-linear plot. It's kind of going back and forth in time, showing the connection between Henshiro and Motome. Saito is none too happy, and Saito is very disrespected. And Sugumu wants to have one of the three people that were involved in harakiri of Motome perform his harakiri. But conveniently, they're all sick at the right time. We'll see where the plot unfolds and where it goes after this, but that harakiri scene was a little hard to stomach with the bamboo sword. You have to have a lot of balls and a lot of determination to stab yourself with a sword and cut your innards out. Alright, film number three in the books, Harakiri. Wow, what a film. 3 for 3 so far. And I think I lied a little bit before when I said I didn't like samurai films. There's a few others out there that I have enjoyed, including this one. This one is awesome. I love the way that the story structure is non-linear. It goes back and forth, filling in the gaps of the story that each person is telling each other. You can almost say it works in a way like a play in some senses. And as the story progresses, we learn why things happened the way that they did. Why did Motome have bamboo swords? Why, what happened to his regular swords? Well, come to find out later on in the story as it progresses that he sold them off to gain some money for his sick and ailing child. Which is also part of why he went to the Lords to commit harakiri, because once again, learning about culture, the way it worked then is that Ronin, which are basically masterless samurai, they would go and request to commit seppuku or harakiri in order to gain alms, which is essentially like donations. It's just their way of gaining money and pity. I don't know why I said it like that. Gaining donations and pity from the Lords because they feel bad for you, I guess, or they want to feel high and mighty, I don't know. That's the way I kind of saw it. One thing I will say is I really like the, it's a small subtle things, especially when they bring Motome back after they've had him kill himself. Pretty realistic blood on the robes. A lot of times when you watch movies with some sort of violence, if you're committing seppuku, there's gonna be a lot of blood. You're gonna be gushing. There's a lot of sequences in movies where the blood and the damage done is not realistic. Also in the same scene, the subtle lighting changes to convey the mood and where to pay attention to was really cool. That was almost play-like. He finishes up his story by talking about the three men that he requested to perform the harakiri for him. He already saw him and he already took care of him in ways. And there's an epic fight between him and Hikokuro. It's very quiet, tense, the wind is blowing. It's slow and meaningful. Every jab of their sword and every slice of their sword, it's premeditated and thought through. And even the big giant battle at the end with all the other samurai is just really well done, well choreographed. It was a sight to behold. And reading here too, it looks like there was a remake made by Takashi Mike. You know what? I think I remember seeing this one on Blu-ray.com. if it's any good. It's a 3D version. A melodramatic deepening and grisly doubling down of Kobayashi's great original. I think that wraps up all my thoughts on it. We're coming down to it. We're over halfway done with this little shindig. And things are looking swell. I have the two other films in mind of what I want to check out. One of them's another Kobayashi film, and the other's another Edward Yang film. And those ones are the beasts that I was talking about. Those ones are going to be the meat and potatoes of this. Why do I keep enunciating?
What an honor for Scott McTominay, captaining Manchester United.
Oh, swinging corner. McTominay got his head to it, and it's in! Scott McTominay with a bouncing header. Ole Gunnar Solskjaer's side eventually get there. They are into the fourth round.
We're back. It's been quite a few weeks. It's currently 6:18 on February 27th. Today we're going to be watching a big one. An epic of Taiwanese cinema. Our first film we watched in this whole thing was Yi Yi by Edward Yang. Today we're gonna be following up with his 1991 film, A Brighter Summer Day. This one came out in 1991, as I just said. It's 237 minutes. That's just under 4 hours. And the synopsis is, a boy experiences first love, friendships, and injustices growing up in 1960s Taiwan. So it sounds like it's going to be kind of one of those, we're just living with this guy, we're just following him as he's growing up. Potentially could have M-word qualities to it. I'm sensing something good from this one. And it's got some pretty big Taiwanese actors. It's got Chang Chen, he was in Crouching Tiger, he's going to be in Dune, he's in a couple Wong Kar-wai films. Lisa Yang, who's never done anything else, according to Letterboxd. I don't want to ramble on for too long because this is going to be a long one. But this is number 4 out of 5 in this Asian film spectacular, spectacle, Asian film spectacle? I hope you guys are liking this so far. I've had a good time putting it together. And if you do, maybe I'll do it for something else. Maybe for like a Federico Fellini one, because his stuff is going to be coming to the collection soon. I don't know. Let me know down below what you think of this, if you like it. We'll see if we can get something else going. But without further ado, I think it's time for the tradition. You know what it is. Masturbation.
Okay,
we're getting pretty deep into this. Trying to find a good place to stop, and things kept happening. I couldn't find a slow spot to pause it, but we're about an hour and a half away from the end. There's a lot going on. Things are going well. At least for me watching it, things aren't really going well for the characters. There's something always going on. Everybody's so angry and conflicted and confused, and I was reading up a little bit about it, and it's saying that obviously it's set in the 50s and 60s, but it's inspired in part by Yang's memories of the sensational coverage of a teenager tried for killing his girlfriend. The film centers on Zhao Sir, a boy from a middle-class home who veers into involvement with gangs and juvenile delinquency. Now, the synopsis that I gave at the beginning didn't really give the film the credit it deserved. The English title is derived from the lyrics of Elvis Presley's Are You Lonesome Tonight? But yeah, there's a lot going on historically. It says that at the beginning, but I looked it up anyway because it made me very curious. And the film's story reflects divisions of nationality, culture, and age in Taiwan a decade after the island was occupied by the nationalist Chinese government following the end of mainland China's civil war and the establishment of the Communist People's Republic of China. Things are changing. The young characters in the film are affected by the social dislocations caused by their family's exile, changes in traditional social values, the turmoil of young love and friendships, and the lack of a clear direction to a meaningful future. So, the sheer fact that they're leaving China they're migrating to Taiwan is causing a lot of friction within families. It's causing a lot of drama with people, and they don't want to do it. So you can see where the drama resides and where it comes from. There's a lot of gang violence going on. That's part of where our main character gets stuck in. And it's not exactly what I expected. I was not expecting gang violence. I was almost expecting more of like military something, which is part of it. There's a lot of military driving around on the streets and their tanks and things. So it's not a very nice time. It's probably pretty politically divided, socially divided, and that's one thing that I keep saying that I really love about watching these films, is learning the culture of these other countries and what they went through, especially in these certain time periods like the 50s and 60s for Taiwan and China. And there's some cultural influence from the United States. You hear some of them talking about Disneyland. You hear them listening to the radio talking about JFK and how he's just this young, inexperienced politician that doesn't know what he's doing. So it's really interesting to hear the side from other countries about America. Something you don't hear. It's a country full of star-spangled awesome idiots that think that it's the greatest country in the world, and it's interesting to hear it from a perspective that is different and views us in a way that is not how we view us. So yeah, things are going well so far. I'm really liking it. Edward Yang, he does something different. He makes like a really quiet and concise sort of movie. So yeah, we have about an hour and a half left. We'll see what other what the fuck moments happen throughout the whole thing.
You're lonesome tonight. You know, someone said the world's a stage and each must play a part. Fate had me playing in love with you as my sweetheart. Act one was where we met. I loved you at first glance.
Damn, dude. I knew it was coming and I still didn't expect to see it. Crazy ending. You know, I think we talked about it in the midway point that this was a story about a guy who killed his girlfriend, but even so, I kind of forgot about it. I lost it in everything else that was going on, and I don't know if that was purposeful or not, but it worked. There's just a lot that goes on with this story besides our main character Zhao Sir. I mean, you got military running in and out of the streets, you've got the radio talking about American politics, you have all these different things going on, and with the runtime you kind of forget about what's going to happen. At least I did. I don't know. Edward Yang seems to be a master in the craft, and I love both things I've seen from him now. But it was a really impressive movie. It never got boring. There was always something to keep you invested. Fortunately, there were no explosions. All right, folks, here we are. The last one in this splendid video. We're gonna be starting out the Human Condition series. We're gonna be starting with part one. I won't be watching part two and three in this video, so if you're curious of my thoughts on the other ones when I get around to them, make sure to follow me on Letterboxd at Filmies Nick. I'll leave a link in the description. But yeah, we're moving on to a Japanese epic. Came out in 1959, directed by Masaki Kobayashi. If you recall, we did watch another movie directed by him, Harakiri. During the Second World War, Japanese conscientious objector Kaji works as a supervisor in a Manchurian prison camp. He hopes to avoid duty as a soldier, but he also hopes to be helpful to the welfare of his prisoners. But an escape attempt by Chinese prisoners results in Kaji's arrest for collusion. He faces the possibility of transferal to combat or worse. So altogether, all three parts, it's about 9 hours. 9 hours, 39 minutes, if I'm being more specific, which makes it one of the longest films ever. And I don't know what it is, at least for me. Longer films are usually always good, but maybe I'm just watching the right ones. Yeah, because we all know that not all of them are good. Zack Snyder's original vision, my fat fucking ass. But once again, we have some great actors. We have Tetsuya Nakadai, who we talked about earlier, who is just like in every good old Japanese film ever made. We have Michio Aratama, who's also been in some really great Japanese films. Chike Jawashima, who's been in several herself, a couple Ozus, several familiar faces throughout it. So it has an average rating of 4.4 on Letterboxd, and we're going to be watching it on the Criterion channel once again. But they did just announce that North America is getting a Criterion release of it soon. But I think that about wraps up the intro for this one, so without further ado, The Human Condition, Part 1. No. Greater. Let me ask everyone out there, have you ever heard of Scrapple before? Definitely a Pennsylvania thing. Let me know if you've tried it before. And if you haven't, I'm not going to tell you what's in it. If you're really curious, just go look it up. But I recommend you at least try it. Don't be alarmed, because it's really, really good. Alrighty then, we're done. We finished this bad boy. The Human Condition, Part 1, No Greater Love, is a rough movie. I can imagine that there were a lot of instances like this in real life where there were not only conscientious objectors, but ones that became rotten due to the behavior that they had to deal with. I mean, for example, in this one, Kaji, he, in order to not have to go fight in the war, he and his wife, they moved to Manchuria to work as a labor chief to a workforce of Chinese prisoners, and the people around him treat them horribly, and he doesn't want to do that. Why would he want to? So he's got his morals and his standards, and it clashes with the ones that these other guys have, which arguably they don't have morals and standards, because, I mean, what they do to these people is horrible. Kaji's trying to implement humane practices to the camp, and they're just not having it. I mean, it even goes as far as some of the prisoners are electrocuted, beheaded, and when Kaji finally protests all of it, they draft him into the army. Like, what the fuck? So you've got this conscientious objector that is trying to do good, but there's a system around him that is so rotten that it's too big for one person. He ends up losing this battle. We'll see what happens in part two. And even so, in this first part, because of what he's dealing with, he's already starting to show signs of disturbing behavior. He's starting to get mad at people, his wife, these prisoners. It's starting to infect him a little bit. But just like the other films, it shows the struggle between different cultures, Japanese, Chinese, and Korean cultures. So there's a lot of infighting going on. And of course, it's messing up the relationship with his wife, and they're sabotaging him, they want him to quit. I mean, it's like Hacksaw Ridge in a lot of senses, where they're just trying to push him to his limits so he'll fuck off, and he's sticking to his principles. It's also interesting to see the perspective of Japan during World War II, because it's not something that, at least over here, we see very often. It is tricky, because Japan was one of the Axis superpowers they weren't really the good guys in the whole situation. And by the end of the war, neither were we. But it's interesting to get the perspective. I haven't really seen it very often other than, like, Clint Eastwood's Letters from Iwo Jima. But yeah, very good first part to the series, I guess. I mean, very good first part of the film. Like I said, I won't be watching any other parts in this video, but if you want to keep up with what I think of the other ones, go ahead and follow me on Letterboxd, Philippines Nick, and I'll leave a description down below. But for now, we've done it. That's it. Like I said, somewhere in the middle, I think we're going to do a little award ceremony. So, why don't you take it away?
And now, the president of the Academy, Mr. Gregory Peck.
Kind of lonesome out here. The audience is already on the inside. Right now, it's my pleasure to introduce to you 10 of Oscar's best friends. First off, my very dear friend,
Nick Beisel.
Movies are for the... They are... Here we are at the ceremony. Movies are for the... here for us to take us to places we have wanted to go but never have gone to. Or never could go. We are here to celebrate the nominees for... Fuck. We are going to nominate some movies to be the best of the bunch that we have watched so far. I'm supposed to make jokes now, and... Meryl. You are the pristine picture of a lady that is blossoming. Even at your age, I would still plow. We finally made it to the end of the show, and in dramatic fashion, we have decided to award Best Picture. Movies are the thing that we do to make entertain us, and these are the films that entertained us over the last few months, and... Here are the nominees.
Every day in life is a first time. Every morning is new. We never live the same day twice.
ところがあるそうですよ。領中さん、そういう撮りました。そうか。静かな海じゃのう。ええ。笑うやつは勝手に笑うがいい。人それぞれの心など到底計り知れるものではない。
I wonder if you're lonesome tonight. You know, someone said the world's a stage and each must play a part. Fate had me playing in love with you as my sweetheart.
Lonesome tonight.
And the award for Best Picture in this spectacular is Yee Yee. Thank you, everyone, and good night.